This week on WealthTrack, why interest rates matter. Credit market maven and historian James Grant shares his wisdom and perspective. He is next on Consuelo Mack WealthTrack.
New York Life, along with Mainstay's family of mutual funds, offers investment and retirement solutions so you can help your clients keep good going.
Additional funding provided by Clearbridge Investments, a Legg Mason company, Thornburg Investment Management, active management, flexible perspective. Ku and Patricia Ewan through the Ewan Foundation, committed to bridging cultural differences, and the Fairholme Foundation.
Hello and welcome to this edition of WealthTrack. I'm Consuelo Mack. How much do interest rates matter? Well, after a decade of historic lows, in certain years, 5,000-year lows in interest rates, we're about to find out. They are starting to rise. A recent front-page story in the New York Times warned that within a decade, interest payments on U.S. debt may exceed the country's entire military budget. The Times reported that the Congressional Budget Office estimates that the cost of interest is on track to hit $390 billion next year, nearly 50% more than in 2017. After a decade of enticingly low interest rates, the world is once again awash in debt. Governments, businesses, and in some cases individuals have loaded up. That load is becoming more burdensome. 35 years ago, financial journalist James Grant left Barron's, where he had originated the current yield column, to start his own publication called Grant's Interest Rate Observer. At the time, 30-year treasuries yielded 12% and 3-month T-bills 9%. Its stated editorial mission was to keep its readers abreast of the things that cause rates to rise and fall and of the forces that tilt the world toward inflation or deflation. It went on to say it intends to keep watch over the bond market, of course, but also over gold, preferred stock, bank shares, foreign exchange, commodities, and other interest-sensitive investments. Grants has done all that and more, and in the process has become a widely read and influential journal for professional investors. Grant himself has written several financial histories, including the Forgotten Depression, 1921, the crash that cured itself, which won the Hayek Prize, and several biographies, including John Adams' Party of One. I asked Grant to start with the basics, why interest rates matter.
They are the most important prices in capitalism. They discount future cash flows. They measure financial risk. You know, the high rate of interest indicates a sketchy credit. And they set investment hurdle rates. They really matter. And it's why they ought to be discovered in the marketplace rather than kind of administered from on high.
In a period as we are in today, or as we have been in, of zero interest rates, for instance, where they are, I think you told me, they are barely discernible.
Right, you can hardly see them on the page.
So the Grant's Interest Rate Observer, you've got your high-powered microscopes out. So do they still matter as far as when they have been manipulated to these levels?
Well, they matter in different ways. Yeah, you've seen trillions of dollars worth of sovereign bond yields priced to yield less than nothing. So imagine the temptation to reach for yield, to strive for a return you can't get on, on safe. I'm going to use sneer quotes, safe investments, because really nothing is purely safe, but safer investments.
Right.
And the result, I think, has been we'll know more within 3 or 4 or 5 years, because we'll then see how many white elephants were created or funded with artificially cheap credit. We'll see how much investment was misdirected under the influence, as it were, under the influence of artificially depressed interest rates. So, I think that we have all, to some degree, been living in a kind of hall of mirrors, misperceiving financial facts under the influence of these very, very low interest rates.
What's so interesting is that for those of us who have lived under these very low interest rates, is that, you know, we've seen an economy recover from a serious recession. We've seen stock prices go up. We haven't seen a lot of damage in the credit markets. I mean, we're seeing, you know, the world economy start to right itself. So it doesn't, you know, I don't see this excessive speculation that you're talking about. Where are you seeing it? Or, but you said in 4 or 5 years, well, we're going to see where...
When the next recession or crisis hits, then we will see how much capital was misdirected in the wrong things. So
where do you think it's been misdirected? Because, you know, what's wrong with people investing in the stock market? And they've certainly been investing in the bond market
absolutely.
In droves.
Right, right. Well, when you see WeWork, for example, this closely held, most venturesome enterprise that leases spaces and buildings and releases them to tenants. When you see WeWork issuing debt, and the criterion for cash flow they use is the kind of the fakey one, EBITDA, which is a very, very loosey-goosey and made-up form of cash flow.
Mm-hmm.
And you see them modify that further by removing costs and call it community-adjusted EBITDA, you know that you're in a very dodgy period with respect to credit. The credit standards have been reduced, and the quality of credit has fallen.
So if interest rates are the kind of the most important financial instrument, and also the most important financial reflection of what's going on in the economy, right? I mean, it's very directly related to credit conditions and business conditions and everything else.
Yeah.
So as we go through this period of normalization of interest rates, as interest rates go higher, is there a point when you can see that in fact that the market is the market starting to take over once again?
Well, I think we ought not to confuse the promise or the expressed determination to normalize with the thing itself.
Uh-huh.
The Fed has been reducing its outsized balance sheet for about a year now, and it's at 5% smaller. So it's
5%. Approximately,
yes. It's deliberate.
Yes.
And they might say that we must be deliberate at being an important job of work we're doing. But, you know, to put the promise of normalization in context, there's still something like $7 trillion worth of sovereign bonds that are quoted at less than zero, as a yield to less than zero. The basic federal funds rate that is the short-term money market rate that is quoted so widely is, as we sit, is kind of a 2% number. But in prior conditions of this kind of booming consumer economy and booming stock market, the federal funds rate would have been not at the rate of inflation or slightly below it, but would have been 3 percentage points above it.
Wow.
So rates are still very accommodative,
mm-hmm.
and one might say, so it seems to me that you can go back and look at eras in which there was a true depression in this country, and rates were kind of like they are now. So
mm-hmm.
we have quasi-recession or depression rates still in the context of a 4% measured rate of GDP growth, at least as measured recently, and of all-time highs in the stock market. So there's a terrific disconnect between interest rates and what is elsewhere going on. And that, to me, again, this is the source of distortion. Now, the distortions sound rather abstract, but I certainly believe that the abstraction will become all too real and present and vivid.
When the next downturn occurs.
The next downturn comes,
So what therefore, looking at the Fed's role in the government and in the credit markets especially, you know, what are you telling your readers to expect?
Well, on form, the rise in the initial stages of a bond bear market, if that's what this is, a very, very slow and steady paced, It took rates exactly 10 years to go from 2.25 in 1946, is the round number, to 3.25 in 1956.
Right.
Now, already we have gone, on the 10-year, we've gone from 1.375 to 3.
3.
So rates have more than doubled in the course of 2 years.
Mm-hmm.
So the tempo or the cadence now would seem a little more brisk, if indeed this is the start of a lengthy upcycle in rates.
Are you seeing an impact from that? I mean, that's a big increase. We're still at, you know, everyone looks at the numbers and they say, oh, 3%, it's really, that's still pretty low. But the increase is huge. So are you seeing any sort of an impact from that kind of an increase in?
You're seeing it.
Where are you seeing it?
I think mortgage activity has been
Declined.
Has been depressed or at the margin.
Dampened.
Dampened.
Right.
I think companies that have borrowed at floating rates are now having to rebudget. You know, the federal government is has got some debt, and it has been paying the most concessionary rates. I think less than 2% on average. So if the interest bill of the federal government were to go back to what's an average interest rate? Say 6%. If you go back to 6% on 18 or 20 trillion of marketable public debt. The interest bill would surpass the defense budget, certainly,
right,
in size. So you're right. To look at the number 3, you think, well, that's a small number, but it is small. As measured against the evident rate of inflation. So since the past 50 or so years, the 10-year Treasury security has yielded something like 2.7% in excess of the rate of inflation on average, something like that. So the rate of inflation now is generously reckoned, let's call it 2.
Mm-hmm.
Not 3, but where it has been close to recently. But say it's 2. So that would make the 10-year yield not at 3-ish, but at 4.5-ish or higher, and that would truly bite. So people say for that reason it can't happen. It can't happen. We can't afford that. Well, just because it would be inexpedient doesn't mean it can't happen.
But that's another reason for the Fed kind of to do everything in its power not to allow
it
to happen.
Well, acceptance.
Right?
Well, don't forget that perhaps the single most important driver of longer term interest rates is the rate of inflation. Now,
yes.
If the Fed were to try to suppress these rates through the creation of more dollars and through the suppression of shorter term interest rates against the direction of business activity, which is onward and upward now, might that not seed a new inflation? There's some signs already of latent inflation.
To credit Grant's Interest Rate Observer and your observations thereof, you basically wrote about the excesses in home mortgages in 2006 and 2007. You recognized the dangers in the markets then. And then in the bottom, near the bottom, it wasn't quite the bottom, in December of 2008, you came out with what you called your Grant's supermodel credit portfolio. You who are not prone to hyperbole, the supermodel credit portfolio, in which you were recommending buying, you know, bonds and investment-grade corporates and bank loans and residential mortgage-backed securities and convertible bonds and junk bonds when the whole world started to fall apart. So where are we in the cycle now,
ten years
later? Is there a Grant's call out there? For
utterly and unconditionally bearish on credit. We are bearish on credit, meaning the promise to pay money, and also on interest rates, which are the pure rates quoted in the Treasury yield curve. We're bearish on these for many number. How much time do we have to control?
So are you actually worried about that companies, that there are a lot of companies out there that may be of dubious credit quality, might not be able to service their debt?
The government might
not be able to service its debt.
At the risk of sounding stone-hearted, I'm not worried about it. I'm impatient for the manifestation of this cycle. I want the cycle to turn. I want the liquidation to begin. I want the weak spots to be exposed. Not like it's my self-interest, as somebody has been talking about this for what seems like forever. But the longer these things longer these upside, longer the misallocation of credit goes on, the worse the down cycle is.
I see.
And one of the problems with the Fed's ministrations in this cycle, it has perpetuated the lives of marginal companies. A surprisingly large percentage of listed companies, both in this country and elsewhere in the world, are unprofitable.
30% of the Russell 2000, according to Royce Associates, don't make any money.
Chuck presented that datum at
Chuck
one of
Royce.
Our events.
Yes. Yeah, it was astonishing.
And even revenues aren't adequate to cover, never mind earnings, or revenues in many cases aren't adequate to cover interest expense, or would not be in the event of a slight uptick in rates or a downtick in revenue owing to a recession. So yeah, I'm expectant. I'm not worried. I've been watching these cycles and writing about them and reading for like, I'm 106 years old. Yeah, for a long time. And I'm champing at the bit for the cycle to turn so we get on to the next thing.
Right.
I eagerly await the opportunity to buy things at discounts, these securities that are just priced for a state of human perfection, which state, Consuelo, was ever so rare.
Mm-hmm. And so in the meantime, how does one make money in the credit markets?
The real money that's going to be made, I think, in the next, I'm not going to give you a date because I couldn't, but the real money to be made is, first of all, husbanding cash.
Right.
Secondly, husbanding patience.
Mm-hmm.
And it's so hard because somebody, there are bargains in the world today. There are, there's some things that are mispriced and promised. So you can't walk around with 100% cash because you know something's going to come around the corner and be even better. But something will happen.
Mm-hmm.
And mispriced securities will turn into bargains. Today's short sales will become tomorrow's fabulous once-a-cycle bargain. And that's when you really make money in credit, to these bonds trading at 50 and 40 and 30 cents in the dollar. I can't wait.
But how ghoulish can we get? You have a reputation as a perma-bear, which is not the case.
People have not checked
but
with
you
my PR
do,
department
I know,
on that.
I know, but you are a critical observer of, God help us, politicians and government officials and monetary officials.
I plead guilty, yes.
Yes, and economists and Wall Street.
Yeah.
So who are you most critical of now? Who's causing the most damage, do you think, now in the economy or financial markets?
Oh, I mean, to begin with, I think that we can all agree that money is not humanity's best subject.
Mm-hmm.
And money often brings out the worst in all of us. And people talk about behavioral finance as if it were kind of a science, but it's like romantic. It's like the science of romance, right? There is none. People write books about it, but still, people do not make rational decisions because
with money or with love.
So that's to begin with. So whom to blame for our difficulties in finance? Well, we have had, I'm about ready to last to lay into the central bankers, but by way of preface, let me observe that we have had cycles of excess, both the upside and the downside, for going back to 1825 in England, which I think is kind of that's the first modern credit liquidation and banking panic. So we can round that off, say 200 years.
Mm-hmm.
That's the first 100 years of that experience was one without the Federal Reserve. Okay, so that's by way of acknowledging that we humans will overdo it, both the upside and the outside. So
with,
who's to blame?
With help or without the help of central banking authorities.
So the people to blame generally are the people who set the incentives, right? If you know who sets the incentives, you will know who is responsible to an important degree for decisions, both good and bad. So who has set in motion the decisions throughout the markets that you really must get out of bank deposits and CDs, and you really must get into equities and help the country through the wealth effect? Though those people were the heads of our central banks, especially the central bank, and particularly the central banker named Ben Espenaki. This was his. He was the spokesperson. I dare say he was not the only one who believed it, but he told America that they must get into common stocks, that they ought to, and he encouraged everyone to help lend a hand with the trickle down theory, then called the portfolio balance channel effect. That was it.
But he was right that we should have gotten involved in the stock market, and a lot of people didn't, and they have not participated in this phenomenal bull market that we've had.
He was correct,
right?
In the what ought to buy low and sell high. He was correct,
yes,
by implying, and indeed perhaps by saying, that America is a great country and that enterprise earns money which, when compounded over time in the mm-hmm. stock market, will make an investor very, very happy he, she invested. All that is correct.
Right. And Warren Buffett would have said the same thing.
Where I fault the Federal Reserve is using, right, is nationalizing or socializing financial markets in the interest of public policy.
Mm.
The Federal Reserve has no business in steering people into the market. It has business in setting or helping us set prices that are discovered through the laws of supply and demand.
Mm-hmm.
The Fed now owns the market. The Fed owns, I'm not sure he won't acknowledge the moral responsibility, but we are now talking, you and I, we're talking at the time of new highs. Everything is lovely. The sky is clear. There's scarcely a cloud the size of a man's hand on the horizon.
Well, the Fed doesn't own this,
of course,
stock market, but it does own a lot of the bond
market. The Fed owns the responsibility,
uh-huh,
has the moral responsibility for directing people into the stock market that would not have gone there before. Suitability was a criterion,
mm-hmm,
of the honest and capable broker, right?
Yes. So
notice that the Fed was inviting us all into the stock market, inviting us. I am over droning on my. I've indicted the Fed at much longer length and with many fewer hems and haws in the written pages of Grant's. But I think, in sum, Consuelo, the Fed ought not to be treating interest rates in particular as instruments of national policy.
Mm-hmm.
They ought to be prices, as discovered.
If there's one investment that we should all own some of in a long-term diversified portfolio, what would it be?
Oh, I'm going to not disappoint you, Consuelo. In this day and age, we should own a little bit of gold, or some gold, because it never goes to zero.
And gold, the bullion, or an ETF, or?
Well, why not own the real McCoy? And, you know, it out-yields almost $7 trillion worth of sovereign debt. You know that?
That's negative interest rates. Yes. That is a very good point,
and
Jim.
And it is one's anchor. And by the way, the purpose of owning this is not necessarily to pass it on to the grandchildren. The purpose of owning gold is to have cash when others don't, and to avail oneself of bargains. There's nothing mysterious or nothing, mm-hmm, nothing mystical about it. I own this stuff in the expectation that there will be a come a time that I'm going to want to buy something cheap, illiquid.
Right.
It might be a bond. Liquidate my gold. Or most, mm-hmm, of it. I hope I have the opportunity and the, mm-hmm, and the courage to do it, and to buy something that's flat on its backside.
Right.
Like a building. Can you imagine a building on its backside having tipped over like this and lying flat there on the ground, cheap because it's on its, you know, but buying an income producing asset after a credit liquidation. That,
right,
is, I hope to live that long, Consuelo. I'm eating properly and getting a lot of exercise in the expectation of being there when this happens.
I'm not sure I want it to happen. I want you to live that long, but I'm not sure I want it to happen. Jim Grant, thank you so much. And happy anniversary for the 35th anniversary
of
Grant's,
Consuelo,
Interest Rate Observer. At the close of every WealthTrack, we try to give you one suggestion to help you build and protect your wealth over the long term. This week's action point is Grant's contrarian one. It is own some gold. Barron's recently devoted a cover story to the precious metal, rediscovering gold and why the out-of-favor metal should be part of your investment portfolio. It made a compelling case. Gold is unloved. It's underperformed at a time when other financial assets have soared. It's relatively cheap, off 35% from its 2011 high of $1,900 an ounce. It is a hedge against inflation, which will be useful as inflation picks up from historically low levels here and abroad. And with stocks at record highs, it is a non-correlated asset. When stock prices fall, which they will eventually do, gold will rally. The easiest way to buy gold is through ETFs, and Barron suggested two. The iShares Gold Trust, symbol IAU, which has lower fees than the traditional older and larger choice, Spider Gold Trust, symbol GLD. As we have said many times on WealthTrack, gold is also an insurance policy against possible disaster, some unforeseen crisis which is bound to occur when least expected. Well, next week, Asia investment pioneer Mark Headley joins us for an exclusive update on the promise and perils of investing in China. You will not want to miss that. To see this program again and other WealthTrack interviews, including our extra interviews, please visit our website, WealthTrack.com. And for those of you who enjoy communicating on social media, please connect with us on Facebook and Twitter. Thanks for watching. Have a lovely weekend and make the week ahead a profitable and a productive one.
New York Life, along with Mainstay's family of mutual funds, offers investment and retirement solutions so you can help your clients keep good going.
Additional funding provided by Clearbridge Investments, a Legg Mason company, Thornburg Investment Management, active management, flexible perspective, Ku and Patricia Ewan through the Ewan Foundation, committed to bridging cultural differences, and the Fairholme Foundation.